Hello everyone. On behalf of Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage and Intact Conservation Institutes, a very warm welcome to our speaker, Professor Arunachalam Ramanan, and all the participants who have gathered, who have taken time out to listen to this talk. This is the inaugural lecture of the Conservation Insights 2020 lecture series, which we are starting. And hopefully in the coming weeks, we have more speakers from India as well as from around the world. Now, to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Arunachalam Ramanan is professor in the Department of Chemistry at the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, since 2005. He was a former head of department from 2009 to 2012 and the founding head of School of Interdisciplinary Research from 2017 to 2019 at IIT Delhi. Now, he has a long-standing interest in solid-state chemistry and material chemistry, and he is fascinated by the diversity in solid-state structure or forms, such as intergrowth, isostructures, polymorphism, molecular isomers, etc. And the need to manipulate these supramolecular aggregations to desired forms, thereby controlling their physical and chemical properties. His current research interests include utilization of hydrogen bond and metal ligand coordination to design multiple forms of pharmaceutical solids as well as coordination polymers. But as would be evident from today's talk, he's also interested in arts, cultural heritage, and conservation. He's also a member of the Scientific Research Advisory Committee of ICI. So that's how we know him. So today he's going to talk about copper materials from ancient civilization to COVID times. The story of copper and its alloys is a chronicle of human endeavor since the Stone Age. Copper materials have contributed immensely to every civilization, so that an age or stage of human history is named after a copper alloy, the Bronze Age. Prior to 19th century, copper was used mainly for its mechanical properties. Later, its function expanded owing to its exceptional thermal and electrical conductivity property. In the 21st century, it is the antimicrobial property of copper materials, though well recognized in the ancient civilization, that has resumed its importance. So in today's talk, Professor Ramanan will highlight with examples how copper materials have evolved over centuries and their significance in art and culture, particularly from ancient civilization to COVID times. Before I request Professor Ramanan to speak, I request all of you to please mute your microphone. Kindly use the chat facility to write in any questions that you have. We'll be taking those at the end of the lecture. And kindly also feed in your name and the organization during the talk so that we do know who all have joined us today. So over to Professor Ramanan. Sir, please, if you could start the talk.
Basically, what I'm going to do is give a bird's eye view of, you know, how, what I feel or how I look at the evolution of copper materials from the early civilization till today. Now, when I say copper, I mean all copper compounds, copper alloys, and various other copper materials. So I will take selected examples under different categories, and then I will try to explain my view of, you know, how copper has gone through and what we should look at it at the end. Okay. Now, we are all very familiar with the progression of civilization from the arboreal to the cave dwelling, and then the Stone Age from old and middle, and then later to Neolithic and Chalcolithic, Iron Age, etc. We are very familiar with this the time period, but it is good to have an idea of what it is. But many a time it also overlaps. So, you know, the materials which I have taken it from different sources, there can be a little error here and there, but I think you can ignore it. This is basically only to get a little bit feeling about what happens. Now, the most important thing that is that took place is when the human civilization was evolving, and when the change took place between Stone Age and, you know, the copper age, because copper was the first metal that human being came across, and since then the whole thing has changed. Okay, now if you really look at it, the center point where this was taking place is almost in Europe and certain part of Europe, mostly around the Nile Valley, Egypt, Sumer, and those civilization, and then also the Mesopotamia, and that is where it started, but then later it spread to the rest of the world. Now the Egyptian used to use the tang symbol basically to denote copper. That is, you know, you can clearly see that, you know, how it looks like, and in their system of hieroglyphs. And the term copper initially came because, in, you know, 6,000 years ago, the copper source were mainly located around the Mediterranean, and Cyprus was one of the places which was giving, you know, the copper source. And so Romans called it A Cyprium, and then later it turned into copper, you know, CU, you know, when the periodic table came into picture. Now, what is important over here is around that time, it was like oil today, copper was an important material to actually, you know, control, you know, places and also control power. Now, around 6th century, you know, the copper was found to be malleable. It can have sharp edges, can be easily shaped into tools and things like that. In the beginning, what they did was mostly they used pure copper. That is how it happened. And then later, you know, as the civilization slowly got accustomed to the, you know, how to maneuver the copper metal, then they started trying to get it from the different sources. That is when the progression towards Bronze and Iron Age took place. Now that was the important time when, you know, the human realized that elements and minerals, you know, which occurs in the geology could be brought into with the air, soil, water, and the living organisms. And then used to smelters, furnaces, and various other things to manipulate it, to manipulate the material for various use. In the initial use stages, they use extensively as a weapon, was very, very important. But in addition to it, they also try to make various other, you know, things which can be used for their routine life. Then initially copper, they didn't recognize that copper is less toxic, but it, you know, as the civilization started progressing, then they were able to work with that technology. Now, try to look at it from the, you know, Indian point of view. Though copper was located, especially in, you know, Indian subcontinent around 2000 BC or so, mainly in the Indus Valley civilization. That is, in fact, if you look at the history, there is nothing like a copper age, especially a bronze age in the southern part of India. Mostly, probably it was there only in the northern part of India. And there are quite a few nice books, and one of them is A Copper and Its Alloys in Ancient India by Chakravarti and Lahiri. And also there are, you know, monographs which are written from different places which are available. But most of them dealt is, I mean, basically looking at the metallurgical aspects. Now, the metallurgy of copper is very, very important. I mean, so in the initial stages, the copper was in the pure, I mean, found in pure form, but it was only in the restricted places, and they could recognize it in terms of the color and also its materials property, you know, from other, you know, metals like gold or silver. Now, archaeological evidence suggests that copper was found somewhere between 8,000 and 5,000 BC. But we need not worry about too much about it. And there is also evidence of mining and annealing in even in the United States. So, some man, you know, learned to, you know, to extract, I mean, basically get copper from other sources, then the technologies like annealing, which is basically, you know, cutting it and making it to different shapes, or casting it, basically, you know, making, you know, different molds and pour molten copper in it and then make different shapes. And then smelting, which became very important. And even today, you know, it is almost similar to what it was a few thousand years ago, where the extraction of copper from different ores took place. Now, this is a stage that technology has become much more favorable for basically crafting copper into different materials. Now, the Egyptians were probably the first to combine copper with other materials. Maybe in the initial stages, it was more like serendipity and also the availability of the particular ore. But what the history suggests is that the initial stages they used, you know, to make it with arsenic ore, but they do realize that it created poisonous, you know, vapor. So then they slightly changed into a tin. So if you look around there, you know, the way things have changed, copper with the different metals, how the chemistry changed with the different metals, mostly it depends on the kind of ores available at the different places. Okay. So anyway, then the next element, which was extensively used by the humans, were based on tin. So the tin-based bronzes were dominated for a very, very long time. And they also realized that the moment you add a tin, another metal into copper, and the properties changed, especially the mechanical properties, which enabled them to make different materials. You know, whichever was all. The other important thing that is the civilization as they progressed, especially by the Egyptians, because they were able to make different kinds of tools, which they used it for agricultures. And also, you know, Egyptians are also aware of, you know, the fashion around that time. So they tried to make a lot of, you know, products based on personal beautification. One of them is they made even mirrors. And they also made other things, you know, the makeup materials, basically, you know, the pigments. Now, another thing which is important around that stage is that the Egyptians did a better job in, you know, innovating the smelting methods in compared to their northern counterparts. So they were probably, you know, I'm not very sure, but what I understand is that they were one of the first few to, you know, adopt this technology called the last wax method. And so over a period of time, again, you know, they made a better products out of it. And around that time, around something like 2500 BC, the copper started moving towards the Asian regions. China was one of them which started using it extensively. They made coins out of it, and they also made many other tools in that. A similar time, the Indian continent also, people started using it, especially around the Indus Valley in the northern part of India. And so you get the earliest findings of bronzes are mainly from places in the current Pakistan's in the north frontiers, Baluchistan's, etc. Okay, around this time, that most of the people were making up from weapons, it's articles which are more of, you know, religious based. Okay, so this is how the things were at the time. Now we need to look at a little bit about the Indian map, and then I have just indicated over here, you know, that red the thing where you can clearly see the places where the copper mines were located. Currently, of course, there are three mines which are very, very important. One is K3, which is very close to Jaipur in Rajasthan, and then one in somewhere in Jharkhand. So these are the places, you know, places where copper sources are available. And in general, copper occurs in almost around 165, you know, mineral forms, mainly the ores. And they can be classified into four groups. The first one is the pure copper. The copper is still available in a pure form, but very, very few places. And the copper also can be, you know, mixed with, meaning in terms of mainly with the other metals like lead, zinc, gold, etc. But most of the copper source essentially comes from either the sulfide ores or the oxide ores. So you have to pay attention here a little bit. So you have mainly the copper sulfide and copper iron sulfide, that is the chalcocite and chalcopyrite, are the major sources of, you know, copper many a time. In addition, copper oxide ores are available, but again, copper ores is not very common because it's very combustion in terms of the technology. Okay. Now we'll just look at a few, specimens which has come through the civilization. The top left, if you look at the corner, you will see the vessels basically from the Harappa Mohenjo-Daro. This dancing girl is a very, very popular one from the Mohenjo-Daro. And nuggets, you know, copper nuggets is basically from the Balakad. It is somewhere around 8th century or 9th century. And then the Buddha statue is again from the central province of India. It's around 11th century or so. The bull from Kalibangan, it's a very, very old one. And this is a cannons, you know, you can find it in many parts of the country. It's basically from gunmetal. And this is from Bichapur. I just given some indication how the copper materials over a period of time have changed. Now, this is one of the implements, you know, very old ones from the Balaghat district, from the central province. Basically, it's a, you know, copper anthropomorph. Okay, and this is a very, very old one. And this is a Buddha statue, again, a very well-known, you may find it in many places. Now here, I took basically the data from this particular book, which written by Baldev Raj and his colleagues. Of course, Baldev Raj is no more. And he is from the former director of IG Car. He wrote a very nice book on Where Gods Come Alive, basically on the South Indian processes. And he has given a very nice overview of many things, you know, right from the metallurgical aspects, and then how things have changed over a period of time, at least in the, you know, late 19th century and in the, you know, in 20th century, you know, the different techniques which were developed to essentially understand and then later, you know, the conserve or preserve the old specimens. Now here I've just given three, you know, examples to illuminate. One is from the East Indian bronze, the Buddha statue. Another is from the Bastar bronze. And another is from the South Indian bronze. If you really look at the intricates, you know, there are a few things which will vary. Of course, it's not obvious over here. But an analysis will tell you that, you know, all the three bronzes, the three materials are made by the same technology, lost wax. However, there is a difference in the composition. If you look at the East Indian, that the Buddha statue, it uses ashtaloha. Basically, it contains the eight elements. You know, apart from copper, you have then silver, gold, etc. Now, the artwork from Bastar is basically either brass. Brass is essentially copper, zinc, and bell metal. Okay, bell metal, you will have, in addition to copper, zinc, you will have lead, tin, etc. In, again, you know, it is not purely, it is going to be copper, zinc or copper lead. Invariably, they add other materials. Sometimes it is because of the ores or sometimes but intentionally. Okay. Whereas the South Indian bronze are essentially mostly, you know, are panchlok. And they are all basically copper, silver, gold, zinc. And sometimes it can be tin or sometimes it can be iron depending on where it is made. Now, another important feature you will look at the materials point of view is while the, you know, bronze from the East Indian and the Bastar is essentially very coarse, whereas the one which comes from the South Indian technology, again, it's similar, but there are some refinement, is very, very fine. And if you look at the, you know, artwork in terms of the iconography, the East Indian bronze are very proportioned. You know, if you look at the structures, then you will see very clearly, you know, you will see that they are all very nicely structured. Whereas when you look at the material from the Bastar side, then they are not. And mainly because they are more of a tribal art. Okay. And whereas if you look at the South Indian bronzes, is much more, you know, the cut is much more finer over there. And that you will see it in terms of the technical quality also. And the time period, if you really see it, whereas in the case of Bastar and the South Indian, it is in the middle of, you know, 8th to, you know, 15th century. In case of South Indian bronzes, mostly they are from the Chola time. Okay. And the patronage, of course, in the earlier stages, is mostly, you know, society oriented. Whereas if you look at the Bastar, you find both the religion and tribal art. So you will see more of a society oriented, you know, specimens as well as more of a religious thing. Whereas when it comes to South Indian, it's mainly, you know, patronized by kings. And that's one of the reasons you'll find a lot of things in the temples and things like that. Again, you will find a lot of sculptors based of gods. Okay. Now, another important material, which when you look at this, is the metallic materials as mirrors. And this is essentially from the Aranmula mirror from Kerala. And I'm sorry that I have given you a phase diagram, because as a scientist, I just can't stop giving such an a diagram here, but it is not to threaten any of you. Now, what is important is the metallic mirrors are known for a very long time, right from the beginning. You know, Egyptians know about it. They used bronze mirrors, and mostly, you know, with the different tin content. Now, the earlier days, the tin contents were very, very high. And there are two major problems. When you have low tin bronzes, then it has a very, very strong material, but it has very limited reflectivity. Now, when you increase the percentage of tin in this, and that's an example of an Aranmula mirror. In fact, Dr. Sharada Srinivasan from, you know, National Institute of Advanced Studies at Bangalore has written a very nice article, and she has also written a few similar aspects. She's a metallurgist. Again, a PhD from ISC Bangalore and my alma mater. And this lady has, analyzed this particular mirror. And what is interesting over here is it's actually not a single compound, but it's really a composite, because you have both alpha and delta phases coming out. Apart from that, you also have a probably a intermetallic compound on that. So if you really look at that mirror, you know, its reflectivity is very, very uniform around. And also, of course, it's not, the strength may not be, you know, very good. But this is what a material scientist invariably does. It. He does the structure property relations. So something which these people in, you know, a few centuries ago have refined it. And it's more of an art. And still, I'm not sure whether the technology is really known. Now, next we'll move to another aspect of, you know, the art materials, mainly the inorganic pigments. And pigments have been used again for many generations. Now, there are lots and lots of pigments, so white, yellow, orange, red of a different kind. But again, in this particular talk, I'm just going to concentrate only on a few of them, like azurite, malachite, verdigris, brochite, which are all based on copper compounds. Okay. In addition to it, of course, some of these things like, you know, Prussian blue, zinc white, and lead chromates are all known, but they were not available during the Middle Ages, because these are all more. Now, when you are looking at the pigments, one of the important pigment is Egyptian blue. Now, what is interesting over here is it is the first synthetic pure material. Of course, it is the same as a rare mineral. You know, it's called cuprorivite. Now, at that time, of course, there were no technology available, so the mineral was also not available. But they had a way of making it almost 5,000 years ago. What they did, they just simply mixed a mixture of calcium carbonate, copper. Copper is basically a malachite source, and the silica sand, which is easily available, and invariably used flash. In those days, it was invariably, you know, soda, sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide. And then they heated it at about 800 to 900 degrees Celsius and made this compound calcium copper silicate, which was an exceptional pigment. Okay, even today, it is very, very important. And but it also it was a pure material similar to that rare mineral that we came to know only recently. Now, other, you know, if you look at our paintings from India, the southern part, there are no copper compounds were used, copper pigments were used. I mean, it is obvious that, because it was not available over there, but there are quite a few Rajasthani paintings where there are, you know, the copper compounds are used. One of them is the verdigris, which is the copper acetate, which is the green material. And then in addition to it, you have azurite and malachite, which are all copper hydroxycarbonates. But unfortunately, not many, you know, analysis have been done on these materials with the recently available, you know, technologies, both spectroscopic and X-ray methods. So I don't find much literature on this. But there is definitely, there is one report where, you know, again from the Baldev Raj group just, 10 years ago, where they have used Raman spectroscopy to analyze some of the, you know, miniaturized printings from the 16th and 17th century. And here the pigments were mainly red lead, lead white and vermilion starch, and there is no trace of any one of the copper materials that I am talking about. Okay, this is another thing which, you know, is from a very recent literature, and it's a very nice paper also. See, what is important is this kind of a research is not happening in countries like this, even though many tools are available. This is something which probably this audience may have to look at it, especially from the Indian, you know, Indian students and the faculty. Now, this is a picture, if you really look at it, and that highlighted regions just near the calf region, if you look at it, that blue color, the blue color essentially comes from azurite. It is a pure copper hydroxycarbonate, a very, very important material. And now they have used various techniques, several X-ray and electron diffraction techniques, and then they have identified the different materials. So here they have the green blue comes from the mineral mixite, you know, bismuth copper arsenate material. So this is very, very important, because when you pick up a mineral from a particular region, it is also very important what are the other types of minerals available over there, because over a period of time, these things will also give you, you know, the importance of it. Now, later when you are looking at it from the conservation point of view or the preservation point of view, you may have to pay attention to this, you know, the composition. It may appear to be a little more complex, but today with the available analytical tools, it is not really. I will give one example at a later stage. Now, historically, copper-based pigments are limited to, as I mentioned, you know, it was thought that it is only limited to, you know, malachite, azurite, etc. But in principle, there are various other copper salts mainly used based on organic and inorganic materials like silicates. They are also used as the pigments. So especially when you are looking at the degradation products, one may have to be very careful that it is not limited to only particular things. So this is very, very important. Another thing to note is malachite and azurite are not stable in fresco. They also discolor in oil. So they do undergo, you know, degradation or reactions, you know, with, you know, binder materials. So they are very, see, many a time the binder materials are organic based materials, and copper has a tendency to form a compound. And copper also can very easily get oxidized. So it's a copper one, copper two, the valency compounds, which will normally turn into different compounds, and then the color will change. So the thing will degrade. So this is another important thing. And so in the context of, you know, preservations, so one may have to look at, you know, the tracking, and then later, you know, understanding the variations. One may have to look at the salt dissolutions and formation, reduction and oxidation reactions, ions leaching, polymorphism, structural modification. All these things now are very, very important today, because now with analytical tools, people are looking at it. In addition to it, you have, you know, your material is exposed to, you know, different humidity, and there are lots of pollutants around, and then contaminants. And some of them are also reacting with the biological things. So all these things we need to look at it. So for preservation, it is very, very important to look at the pigment binder interactions, which is not really looked at till recently. And it's going to be very different from when you look at the single component or a multi-component. The another thing is also you have to look at the, you know, air control, I mean air quality in a particular regions and also the climate, because these things will make a complete change with respect to the material. You just go because with copper patina, I think everybody is very familiar with that, because copper invariably has a tendency, this has been recognized almost 6,000 years ago, since the beginning, where the copper reacts with the atmospheric materials like hydrogen, water, carbon dioxide, and if it is an acidic vapor, so then they invariably form what are called copper hydroxide carbonates. And one good thing was that it invariably formed a layer. Now these are all the layer. Not only it gave aesthetic value, but it was also protecting further, you know, degradation of the material. Wherever you had that, you know, copper sheets that on the domes, then this is a reaction is invariably, you know, the formation of copper carbonates. Now, but we need to look at it a little carefully. This, I think many of you may have these coins with copper coins, and then over a period of time you can see the changes, and these changes are mainly an oxidation. So it forms cuprous oxide and cupric oxide. Now, but if they are exposed to an atmosphere where there is a considerable amount of carbon dioxide, and also if they are buried, then things can change. So you will find in the old coins, you will see the blue and the green tinge. The blue and green tinge basically comes as a result of invariably the formation of the copper hydroxycarbonates. Okay. So, and copper hydroxycarbonates are, as I mentioned earlier, it is not, you know, damaging in the sense, it only makes a passive layer and it doesn't allow the penetration of other things getting into the product, so the copper will be safe. But on the other hand, if there is a environment wherein you have the copper exposed to chloride, you know, especially in an acidic environment where you have a chloride in the medium, then there is a tendency for the copper chloride to form. So in such cases, then what happens is that this is called a Brown's disease. Now, here I have given two examples, one from a very old Egyptian bronze and another one is from the copper tin bronze. Now, this is a very common problem which copper alloys or copper exposed to a chloride medium invariably gets affected and forms a blue layer. Now, the blue layer will look, many of the copper carbonates also, for example, if you mix malachite and azurite a little bit, it will look very similar color, or even the copper carbonate. So color is not just important, but there is a difference between that and here. Here it will happen in a small region. And also when you touch the surface, you will notice that it will be very powdery, you know, and this forms basically, you know, this is again a mineral called a nantokite, and it is nothing but the cuprous chloride. Okay, the cuprous chloride again can get oxidized to cupric chloride and can react with water, and then the different products can form. So this is how this so-called Brown's disease occur, and this is invariably a problem. Again, this cartoon, I took it from, you know, basically from the Baldev Raj book, wherein he has shown, you know, how the bronze gets, you know, affected at the surface. And today, of course, there are lots of surface analytical tools are available to really, you know, monitor all these things. So the surface is essentially carbonates, which are basically, you know, hydroxycarbonates and be mostly, you know, malachites. And below that, what you have is the cuprous oxide formation, because in different environment, there is also a possibility of a reduction. And here, the cuprous chloride is buried a little below that. And the cuprous chloride is invariably CuCl. But the moment it is exposed to oxygen and water, then the problem comes where it can, you know, react and then forms copper hydroxychlorides. So that I'll tell you that there are compounds called atacamides, paratacamides. So these compounds have a tendency to absorb water, so they will try to swell. So this is a very big problem. That is why this Brown's disease is a major issue. Now here, when you look at that Liberty statue, because if you remember, the Liberty statue was constructed, you know, almost 250 years ago, 1776, for the first 30-40 years, it was almost, you know, the nice copper color, the reddish brown. But then slowly it started becoming, you know, greenish or slightly bluish. Now here it is not the copper carbonate formation. What you have to realize is this: around this place, you know, this is located in the western part of the Manhattan Island. Over there, you know, there were a lot of thermal power plants, especially in the New Jersey area. So a considerable amount of, because they are coal mines, so they had considerable amount of sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere. And the sulfur dioxide reacted, and then it formed a material called copper sulfate hydroxide. Again, there are different copper hydroxide sulfate, but this is the major compound, the so-called bronchantite. The bronchantite is also a well-known mineral. Okay, so this is what you find it, especially with respect to the Liberty statue. So here it is mainly again a patination, so it is a formation of a layer which act like a protective layer. Now, bronze disease, I already mentioned to you that the moment it comes in contact with the chloride, then it is always a problem. The one way to remove it is basically, you know, use a small brush and then you can remove it slowly. Or it is possible to do, you know, a coating with, you know, an organic substance called benzotriazole. It's basically a benzene molecule connected with another 5-membered ring with the triazole. Let's not get into it. And this is a very, very well-known corrosion inhibitor. I don't think that there is really a substitute for this. Basically, you know, copper forms a very strong complex with this particular material, copper benzotriazole, and it forms again a layer around it. So that is what it protects, you know, the penetration of, you know, water and other things inside, you know, where exposing the copper chloride layer buried inside the protective layer. So this is the best way of, you know, preventing it. And nowadays they also have, you know, there are other, you know, materials. One of them is the so-called perlite, which they use it. Again, it is also possible to do, you know, using electrochemistry, you can try to coat it, a passive coating on it. That is also people are trying it. But bronze disease always a problem to rectify. So it is always better to prevent it. Okay, then here I want to bring out another example, because especially in India, we have never used the X-ray diffraction technique, actually. That is my expertise also. To look at, you know, to understand what is happening with the art objects, especially the heritage materials, and you know, how do we understand the kind of chemistry. So here I have just given one particular material. It's actually a copper, and the copper is kept on basically a soda glass. Now what happens is, over a period of time, when the copper gets oxidized, and also there is a soda, so there is a sodium ion available in the medium, and then the wood storage, because you normally, you know, many people, you know, keep many things like adhesives, binders, various things in the wooden storage carbonates. So there is a considerable amount of formaldehyde which gets, because any wood material, you know, invariably exposed to this kind of an organic vapor will slowly form, and formaldehyde, and formaldehyde gets converted into formic acid, and then the soda is available, basically the sodium. So the sodium formate and the copper forms this particular complex compound. So this is an important thing one may have to look at it. Earlier, people were not looking at it because they didn't have the analytical tool. But today, you know, various analytical tools are available. So the crystallization of a different material occurs in such kind of an object. Many a time, just by looking at the color, a blue color or a green color, we may be, you know, thinking that it is, you know, the known malachite and azurite, but unfortunately it is not so. So it is very, very important, especially for the conservation people, to, you know what is the kind of environment they work. Now, we'll just try to give you, these are the materials known, which are, you know, important from the corrosion point of view, which is known. I have already mentioned some of them. The cuprite, that Cu2O cuprite, is a red color, and that copper oxide, copper hydroxycarbonate, you will notice copper hydroxycarbonate, it is only the copper to carbonate, you know, composition varies, but otherwise it is only those two compounds. And if there is a sodium something available, especially an alkali thing, then it will form a sodium copper carbonate, bluish green. And now when you look at this copper hydroxychloride, which I told you in the bronze disease, where the cuprous chloride, that is that nantokite, it, when it gets exposed to, you know, water, then it can form any one of the three forms. The composition is exactly the same, but the color will vary and the structure is different. They are called the polymorphs. Same structure, same composition, but different structures. So that is also very, very important. And so these are the main materials which in relation only to the top layer and the third one. This is the azurite turning into malachite over a period of time. You know, you look at the mineral, this is very, very unusual. Azurite, because basically what happens is azurite contains more carbonate. When it comes in contact with the acid vapor, then it slowly, you know, it removes certain amount of carbon dioxide, then it converts into malachite. So it's a very, very important problem. And this can happen in all your paintings. And even if you have products made of azurite, that will invariably, if it is exposed to acidic vapor, will slowly change into irreversible to a malachite. And look at, you know, what is happening. So the 19th century and then later in the 20th century, you know, the copper materials have become very, very critical. That is very, very important. And so when you look at it, the sources, copper sources, the copper sources mainly still, it is in, you know, in Latin America, Chile and Peru, a large amount of it. And of course, you also may have to realize that there is a considerable problem of pollution over there. And China is another big player in that. And then USA is another one. And so the materials in the middle of 19th century and then 20th century, the people have started realizing the alloying properties, and then they have started using a different kinds of metal. And in this connection, in the recent time, you know, copper nickel alloy is very, very important because it's, you know, non-corrosive, and it is used in different materials. And then copper zinc, which is, you know, very well known old materials, but it has a very interesting acoustic properties which has been realized only recently. Of course, it is known early, but now if you look at a variety of musical instruments, you know, are made of this, you know, exploiting the properties of these things. Now, this is that, if you look at that, this is basically one from the basically in a shopping center. And if you look at materials where it is being used in United States for building construction, is almost 5%. Electrical, it's around 20%. So across the countries, it's basically, this is how it is, though the statistics may be different in India. Okay, now in the India, so if anybody who comes to the Delhi airport will invariably see it, it's essentially a copper plate. And recently, of course, there were a lot of controversies surrounding the Yes. I'll finish it in 5-10 minutes. And this is a Sardar Patel statue, which recently they, you know, opened it in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. And they, interestingly, I don't know, you know, unlike Liberty statue, you know, this temple, Spring Temple Buddha, it is also a giant bronze, but it has not undergone any patina formation. I don't know why. I really don't know what is the composition. And with respect to that, you know, the Sardar Patel, that metal also, I am not very sure, though it is bronze, they claim. And this is a home. I mean, it is very close to the US Embassy in Delhi only. It's near the Malcha Mark. It's called the Umber home, and a considerable amount of copper is there on the, in a house. Now, this is just a house, you know, architecture where things do vary. Sorry, it just, if you look at it, you know, there are different coppers is used at different points. And Now, this is a very, very, you know, important place, especially in the New York City in Manhattan. Near the 42nd Street, you have the Grand Terminal, Grand Central Terminal. And over there, they have used, I mean, a large amount of, you know, copper materials to renovate them. And you will, you know, if you happen to go there, then it will be very interesting to look at it. And and this is, you know, the tree basically tells you that the different kinds of elements that can be alloyed with copper. And then you have more than 400 materials known. And if you really look at that copper alloys, I've just listed just four of them. The bronze, which is more well known, with the tin, where the percentage varies anything between 4% to, you know, 50-60%. And, you know, it has been used for various purposes. Copper brands, I already mentioned to you, one of the important property today, apart from various things, is, you know, the antimicrobial, which I will mention it in a minute, and also the acoustic properties. Then the gun metals have been used in the, you know, in 8th, 9th centuries. And then copper nickel is a, you know, corrosion resistance, which is used in marine resistant environment. And nowadays, you know, in near the fisheries, they use considerable amount of this material. And beryllium copper is the hardest material known among these alloys. Okay. And so next, I think the last few minutes, I'll just indicate about, you know, how copper has changed from the, you know, caves to, you know, COVID time. This is a cave from the Himachal Pradesh. And this gentleman is one of them who is working a lot on Michael Smith, a microbiologist and immunologist, you know, from South Carolina, on healthcare settings. I mean, it is not that it is known only today. This has been there for the last 15 years or so. A lot of literature where people started re-looking at the antimicrobial properties, antiviral properties of copper. Okay, so 3,200 years ago, I mean, in BC, you know, that there is an early recording of copper being used as a sanitizer. You know, it is recorded in that so-called oldest Egyptian document. Now, Greeks know also, they used it for pulmonary diseases, basically for lung problems, you know, they used to use. And drinking water for a very long time, people were using it. And Chinese used copper coins, you know, in medication. This is also known. Indians were also using it. And the Phoenicians used, you know, in wounds and, you know, to control, prevent infection. And it is only in the 18th century they recognized, you know, the fungi don't grow on grains sprayed with copper sulfate. I don't know how many of you are familiar. If you look at the agricultural sector, copper sulfates and copper hydroxychlorides are extensively used as disinfectants. Okay. And it is only 1950 the biocidal properties, you know, were recognized in the laboratory for the first time. Anyway, pathogens responsible for the long things. This is another gentleman, Kivil, from the microbiologist from the Southampton. He worked a lot and then he did show quite a few, you know, positive things that the copper alloy surfaces are ideal, actually can be, you know, wherever in the, you know, hospitals or anywhere you have an infection possible. I mean, in any public places, the touch-free surfaces can be, you know, coated with, you know, copper alloys. But there are still, it is premature. It is very difficult to say whether it is good for COVID or not. But they have some initial, you know, research which indicates that they are, you know, good for basically killing these bacteria, I mean, viruses. Now, in the recent time, I mean, this is another things which have happened in various ways, how things have changed, anti-fouling, antiviral properties, wound dressings, antifungal. So enormous things. Nowadays, you have a copper nano powders and then they are making, you know, textile materials. Even IIT Delhi is doing something in that line. So there are quite a lot of things that are coming out. I mean, it will take another few years to see how successful it is. Okay. So one of the reasons for this is basically, you know, why the copper surface is very, very important is basically it's because of the redox species and which, you know, create this very active hydroxyl radicals. I won't really go into the mechanisms, but at least just to bring your attention to this particular thing. This is known in different metals also. It's known in iron and other things. But to the copper, it's a similar mechanism probably takes place. So there are some initial evidences for this, and this is responsible for the so-called contact killing, you know, why the virus or the bacteria, or the germs gets killed on the copper surfaces or copper alloy surfaces immediately, you know. So that's one of the things. And looking at, you know, the future perspectives. See, I think in India, especially I'm talking in the Indian context, you know, there is an important to conserve the cultural heritage, but somehow it has not percolated both in education and research. There are a few players who are working in a few places here and there, but today it has become completely an interdisciplinary area where you need to have the competence and skills of people from different, you know, domains. And India also do not have a good database. Maybe here and there it is available, but it is, I don't think that when I really look at the papers, I think we are quite far behind it. Now, another thing is there is a problem of production and exploring. You remember till 2 years ago, there was, you know, we were fourth, I think, in exporting copper. But after the, you know, the Vedanta company, Sterlite, got closed in Thoothukudi for various reasons, because pollution is a major problem with many of them. And so our production has come down, and we now started importing a lot, and mainly from other countries. And now Pakistan is also exporting more. So it is necessary now, since that demand is going to increase, this is something which we may have to look at it. But one thing, as a researcher, you know, what is important is that there is a lot of scope in terms of interfacial chemistry or surface chemistry, combined with both material science and engineering. You know, we do have the expertise available around, all around, but unfortunately we had to bring them on a platform and make use of, you know, the range of modern analytical tools that are available. Today you have handheld guns, you have Raman, you have XRF, you have powder diffraction, you have access to synchrotron. So there are so many facilities available, both non-destructive techniques and other conventional spectroscopic techniques. So one may have to use all these things to learn, you know, what happens, because the environment is changing continuously, and we need to be, you know, continuously in touch with them, you know, how these materials undergo changes. So I think I will stop over here, and thank you all once again for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts on this particular thing. I'm not really an expert, but I do have a lot of interest in this particular area. Now I'll complete my talk by just showing this Nataraja statue, which was given by the Indian government to CERN in Switzerland, you know, where you have the Alden Collider. Thank you very much. Hello?
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Ramanan. I think we had a very interesting and exciting talk. I'm hoping that there are questions. So in case...
I don't know whether I was going slow or I was going fast. I'm not...
I think...
When you're giving a lecture in the class, you know, that time you are able to, you know...
No, I think it was clear. And in case, if you have questions... Any questions?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Ma'am, if you could identify yourself and then...
I'm Lakshmi Krishnamurthy, HOD Visual Arts Kalakshetra Foundation, an artist, a researcher, a writer. My question is, he was saying, you know, the grains and other things are getting coated with copper sulfate as a preservative. We all know about it, but also the instructions should be given along because it is a poisonous material which has to be removed before consumption. Isn't that so?
Madhuma?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
That's a nice observation. Anybody else? Any questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Can I?
Yeah, please go ahead.
My name is Anupam. Anupam Sa. I just want to thank Dr. Ramana and ask him that in India, for various things, everybody uses different concentrations of materials. For BTA, we have seen applications of benzotriazole at 0.2% to people using up to 5% also. And we all know that BTA works at a very nano level. So what would be a good application coat? What concentration would be sufficient, you know, other, instead of forming that white powder on top?
Professor Ramanan?
Sorry.
Yeah. Question. It was a question.
Yeah, I got the question.
Yeah.
He was talking about, you know, what is the kind of concentration level that has to be applied to these things. Well, I am not somebody who has been practicing this. I have read it in various research articles. Now, I can only tell this much that, you know, it is very difficult because everything depends on the kind of material you are using it, that the antique material, and what is the level of the copper chloride present on it. And also one may have, you know, it's very, very difficult to estimate, you know, how much you require it. But generally, by looking at or by on the basis of what I have read, all that you require it is this formation of a copper BTA complex. It very nicely it forms an insoluble complex immediately.
Yes. So
it forms a coating. Then what happens is that coating will be, you know, in a micron. So you yes. can see how much it is. So that coating is good enough to prevent further, you know, deterioration. That's what I think.
Yeah, because we generally recommend a concentration of less than, you know, between 0.2 and 0.5%. But everybody is insisting on giving 5%, 10%, because it's also dangerous for the people. But, you know,
on the basis of the chemistry, I don't think that you have to really use a large concentration.
Yes, exactly. That's what.
Question. Is that all, Anupam?
That's good enough for people to think about not to use too high concentrations.
Yeah, thank you. A question from Sri Kumar Menon. Is azurite and malachite found in nature together? If so, would there be a reason for omitting malachite as a green pigment for paintings, which is observed in many schemes of paintings? See, the question is,
both, you know, naturally occurring minerals, both malachite and azurite. And if you look at the composition, see, this is something which we are still, I mean, that is the area where I am working, the area called the crystal engineering. The crystallization of a particular material in terms of the composition itself, it's not very easy to, you know, discuss at this stage. But what we know is that when, depending on, you know, the conditions, environmental conditions, in principle, in the laboratory also, you can make malachite and you can make azurite. Now, the thing is that azurite has a tendency to react with acidic vapor. The moment that reaction occurs with the acidic vapor, that means it is going to lose the carbonate. And that is why it changes to the green color. So the change of blue to green is an irreversible process. You will not be able to make the green compound go to, you know, the green compound going into the blue compound. Now, why the color is different? That's what the question is, right?
Yeah, it says if so, there should be a reason for omitting Would there be a reason for omitting malachite as a green pigment for paintings, which is observed in many schemes of paintings? Can we then omit it as a green pigment?
You know, it is a green pigment, but the issue is we need to check whether it is really a malachite or it can be other copper compounds or there can be some other, you know, green compound also. For example, in India, whatever I have read, the two or three books, the only in the Rajasthan around that area, only they have been using this copper carbonates as a green material. Rest of the places, especially down south, you look at all the cave paintings, Ajanta, Ellora, or even below, you know, in Tamil Nadu, various places, Andhra, nobody has used this particular, probably it was not available. Okay, and you know, nowadays people make copper patina, you know, in various shops you can get it, and they are not copper carbonates. You can't make copper carbonates by coating something. They are all essentially copper acetate. They are all verdigris, where you know you can easily take a tamarind or you can take various sources and then you can make copper patina. It may look similar, but this is not copper carbonate, but they are copper acetate. So you need to have really, you know, either a spectroscopic technique. Most of the time they use Raman. That means they need to have appropriate database to check it, and then X-ray diffraction technique to go with it to identify the material.
So I think what Shri Kumar Menon meant was the malachite is omitted in some painting schemes for green pigments, whereas azurite has been found to be used. I think we have answered that.
Azurite question.
You said malachite is omitted in some painted schemes for green pigments, whereas azurite has been found to be used. That's what he's...
No. I think that is not a problem. I don't think that should be an issue.
Okay.
Azurite will turn into green only if it is exposed to acidic vapor. Otherwise, it will not happen. Azurite and malachite, if they are present together, it is very unlikely to have a reaction. Yeah, I mean, it's possible in the sense... If you provide a medium which, you know, you give a little bit of an acid, then things can change.
Okay. Now, another question from Mahinder Singh Gill. He says, you mentioned that the South Indian bronzes are technically superior to those from Bastar and Eastern India. Could you please explain this a little bit more?
Well, I mean, again, you know, what I have read is mainly, you know, my data is from Baldev Raj work from IG Car. And this book is also available, The Gods, Where Gods Come Alive. And I think, you know, I don't know whether, because I try to look at it. I mean, they have given this particular data. And then I try to look at it, where exactly is it because of the technical quality of the person, which is possible. Because over there was a big patronage from the royal family. So they were able to really encourage, you know, good artisans. That may be one of the reasons, I think. If you look at the Bastar, it's basically a tribal art. So there was not much of a, you know, patronage. So mainly, you know, it was, they were practicing, maybe the skill was not, fine-tuned. That's what I think. Another thing is probably somebody like, you know, a metallurgist, if Dr. Sharada Srinivasan or somebody is there, that maybe whether they had the smelting, you know, everybody uses the same last wax processes, but probably their making of the bronze was a better quality, or it can be based on their type of ores they were using it. So there are different things. But in general, since I grew up from there, when you carefully look at it, the South Indian bronzes will see, you know, a much superior quality in comparison to what you normally find from the northern part. I mean, this is just an observation and what I have read. Okay. I think somebody, you know, an expert probably will be able to see. I mean,
okay. We have a question from Ms. Martina Saran. Is it good and safe to drink from overnight kept water in the copper vessels widely available nowadays? And also, when does it actually become hazardous to drink? For now, probably that's the question.
You know, anything that is available in India, you have to be looking at it with the suspicion. many of the copper vessels that are being sold in the market are poorly, I mean, they're all plated. You remember how they did it, how good it is, I really don't know. We also have it. But in general, it is fine. You know, copper drinking water, there is no problem. As long as you clean it regularly, there is no problem. See, in the olden days, they used to have sometimes, depending on, you know, if they cook something like, you know, I come from South, so when you cook sambar rasam, which is acidic medium, then there is a reaction. You will see the green color formation. Okay. But otherwise, well, you know, it's generally, it's safe. There is no problem. But drinking water, yeah, most of them are fine. But you have to be careful where you choose your product.
Now, again from Sri Kumar Menon, he's saying green is also obtained by mixing blue and yellow pigments. So, any thoughts on that? If you're obtaining green...
That's the common physics, right? And you get it. That is not an issue. if you look at the paintings, why they used... You know, a particular paint, it's most of the time it is because what is available over there. And over a period of time also, they would have noticed that the, you know, different things don't mix, or they, when they mix, then their different coloration occurs. So there can be issues of that kind.
Okay. Now sculptors use copper nitrate for patina formation. Are there any safety issues with this?
Chloride is a problem. Nitrate should not be, because it is not an issue.
Okay.
What is that you are doing it? With a patina formation, what is that your compound you are going to form? If you are going to form copper carbonate, invariably it will be amorphous. Don't be crystalline. It's very difficult to crystallize. Or it will be copper hydroxycarbonate. All you need to do it is you need to oxidize copper, and then in the atmosphere you have water and you have carbon dioxide, so the reaction will take place. Okay, so it doesn't matter really. Chloride is a problem. Nitrate doesn't go in. Chloride is the one which gets buried inside, so that is a problem.
The person using it, safety issue?
Safety issue, you know, nitrate is not an issue. I mean, you know, you are going to use dilute, you know, substances. You have to be careful. Any acid you use, you have to be careful, but it is in the dilute medium, so that's not a problem.
Okay. Any other questions?
I had made a water. Can I?
Yeah, please.
Sure.
Okay, I'm a painter and I made a copper sheet metal emboss frame. And heated it to get a green color for the pulses, and that is still there. So I can do, although he was using it for the cutlass, which is used for upholstery needle, the cutlass made of copper. So I use the same technique for sheet metal embossing. Instead of polishing everything, I just left areas and heated only that area so that I could get a green color. So, what do you
audible?
What is your criticism about it like?
Yeah, ma'am, could you repeat your question? The initial part was not very clear. It was not audible. Could you please repeat the question?
Yeah. It is a copper sheet metal embossed frame, because I wanted a house. Since according to iconography, has to be green in color. Not green means the poster green or the bright green, but anyway, that patina. So what I did was annealing, you must have heard of. So heated it into different temperatures, different parts of the wheel. It is a 3 feet diameter. So I was able to get the green color. It still stays. So what is the compound or what's the permanence about
that, etc.? When you heat copper, invariably it is going to get
toxic. I don't have it here, it's upstairs, so I can't show you that. Okay, that's the process, is it?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yes?
When you heat copper, the copper invariably oxidized.
So okay.
Cuprous oxide or cupric oxide. And the moment they, I mean, cuprous oxide is red in color and cupric oxide is black in color. The way you are getting a green, that means it is forming a compound with, especially a copper 2+ compound, that means with the cuprous oxide reacts with something that is available in the atmosphere. It can be, you know, any compound which chloride is very unlikely at that kind of a temperature reacting with the carbonate, because the carbon dioxide adsorption will be very, very limited unless you have it, put it in some kind of a water with something.
No, it was done in the sculptures studio where they do all the sculptures. So that's place where they do it. It's an open pit kind of a thing. No?
Yeah, then one may have to really look at what exactly is available around it.
Okay.
The best way to do it is once you get the green color, then get it examined.
Yeah.
That is not a problem.
Okay. Okay.
Invariably, it is a copper 2+ compound.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome, madam.
The one wanted to know about the percentages of in brass and bronze.
See, nowadays bronze is more of a general term, and bronze earlier it is mostly copper and tin, and today I mentioned there are something like 400 alloys. Even EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, they have already approved something like 400 alloys, which are more, appropriate for the antimicrobial property. Now the variation, there is a considerable amount of variations. So today phase diagram is available. Nobody can just tell what is this percentage. You need to know what is that, it varies. Copper, zinc also, it varies widely. So a material which you use, what exactly is the composition is difficult to tell.
Okay. Now, a little fact check. Mr. Alok Tripathi has mentioned that according to him, the Sardar Patel statue is probably made up of iron. Maninder Singhal has mentioned that the discs at the airport are essentially spun aluminium electroplated with copper.
Copper. Yeah, yeah. That is right. Because weight is an important thing. That's the reason.
Yeah.
Sardar Patel, my sources says that it is bronze. How much it is, whether it is a plated, because you look at the color definitely doesn't look like a copper, but
yeah,
I'm not very sure about the picture.
Okay. Now there's a question from Mr. Anupam Shah again. Sometimes we see a red color under the green corrosion layer. Is it natural or artificially layered?
Which one?
A red layer observed under the green corrosion layer.
Correct. That is fine.
Is it natural or artificially layered such?
No. That is, if you remember that I just gave you that picture, that bronze disease where it is invariably, the copper gets oxidized. You will have a CO2 layer above which actually the copper carbonate formation occurs. So that is not very uncommon. That's true. But it can vary. It depends on the place. Most of the time we don't worry about, because everything depends on a particular place, particular environmental condition. See, this is where, even when I was reading several articles, things can completely differ from one to another place. This is why I gave you the Liberty statue. Immediately everybody will think it is a copper carbonate, but it is not copper carbonate, it is copper sulfate. The origin of the sulfate came because there was a, thermal power plant close by, a coal plant close by. So one may have to really look at, I don't know. Sterlite was, working for several years in Tuticorin. One may have to really look at what is the kind of copper products over there. If somebody can really look at it, then we will learn a lot. Because it's a very polluted atmosphere, and how, many people over in that region uses copper vessels, brass vessels. So it will be really interesting.
Any other questions? You could either type it in the chat or we can hear you. Any other questions? Any observations? We have one more. Questions are coming now. Mr. Pavan Durai is observing that question of azurite and malachite, thermal studies have found that it is azurite.
Sorry?
He's saying that thermal studies are important to distinguish between azurite and malachite. Mr. Durai, can you hear me?
Hello, can anyone hear, everyone hear me?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Okay, so basically the question was like, why azurite is found, why malachite is omitted?
No, I didn't say azurite is found, malachite is omitted. What I said
was... Not your question, sir. It was the question from the participant.
Yeah. So
if the person want to like on thermal studies that have been found that azurite is more stable as compared to malachite to high temperatures and those things, because malachite gets decomposed with time and everything.
So chances of finding azurite are more according to you.
Yeah.
Okay. No. Thermal property. Well, I don't know. Offhand, I cannot say it. That is possible. I'm not saying that. See, stability is something different. You know, thermal stability is different. It depends on the structure, right?
Yeah.
Whereas, I mean, carbonate content is more over there in azurite. But what I was trying to tell you is that this is a phenomenon which has been observed for a very long time, where azurite, you know, I mean, I saw it in Russia, where in a museum, where almost a room size, crystal, I mean, lots of crystals, of course, together, azurite, half of them turn into green. I mean, even I had quite a few samples with me. So this is very, very unusual. And why does it happen? It can only happen because the azurite gets in contact with any acidic vapor. So there is a chemical reaction. Now, what people have not really looked at it is that how does the reaction occurs? See, here it is a solid vapor reaction. You have a solid which is in contact with vapor. So what happens is a different crystallization occurs. It's a different issue. You know, crystallization still is far away from understood. We know that it forms and we know what is the crystal structure, but how does the transformation occurs from one to another? It's very, very difficult at this stage. So thermal stability is something different. Yes, it can be right that azurite may be more stable than malachite. All I'm trying to tell is that if azurite is exposed to acidic vapor, then it will lose carbonate and it will turn into green, which is basically converting into malachite. Okay, that phase transformation is a very, very important observation.
Okay, got it. I got your point, sir.
Thank you. Any other question? Okay, then I think now it's time
I will make one comment. I mean, I'm looking at as a solid state chemist, the materials person. And, I have very limited exposure to looking very closely into the various materials from the heritage point of view. But what is important over there is this: the surface chemistry plays a very, very important role. And I think there are quite a few people in the interfacial science, they are looking at it. And today people are looking at how colloids can be used. I mean, somebody was mentioning about, the percentage of BTA, benzotriazole, that corrosion inhibitor. And, nowadays you use colloids. Colloids means where you take the benzotriazole and probably disperse it in a medium. And then probably even now that is what they are doing it, the percentage may be different, I think, right? And so the application of it. So number one, the concentration. Number two, how much it is adhering to the surface. So that is also another point, because many a time the surface may not be adhering it properly, so it may not be useful. And if you are in a hurry, probably you think that you put more concentration, it is better. So these are all things which one may have to look at it much more closely.
Okay, then if there are no other questions, it's for me to thank you, Professor Anuradharamanan, from everyone from TAC and everyone who's participated today. Thank you so much for taking out the time. We'll be having more lectures in the future. So please do keep yourself and coming for these lectures encourages to continue with this. So
thank you very much. And I audience are welcome to get in touch with me through email. And yeah, if whatever I can help, I'm sure. Or they can also, teach me where I think I may not be knowing it. So I'll be very happy to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, then.
Thank you, sir.